I can't imagine a better place to own a business than BC's beautiful Sunshine Coast. In this episode, we're going to talk about why Gibsons is a great place to live, work, and invest.
Tony, we both own businesses on the Sunshine Coast. What is it about this region that makes it such a great place to want to invest?
I think there's many factors, not the least of which being it's a beautiful place and people are very friendly. I find whether it was when I owned restaurants or working as a commercial realtor with other business owners and help and facilitate sales of businesses, that kind of thing. The community is very supportive and very much into supporting local and buying local. So I find that that's a major factor when you're either buying a business or starting up a business, that you do have that community support and everyone is happy to see, local success stories. The other thing I find, people that are business owners or have owned businesses before, no matter what industry it is there isn't a lot of advertising done here. So I find that if you do understand marketing a little bit and are willing to, apply some budget to your business and percentage of the profits, that it makes it quite easy to gain substantial market share in a relatively short period of time.
And from a personal or a family standpoint, this is a really nice place to live. Like it's safe, it's quiet. The community is accepting of a business, but it's also accepting of new people.
Absolutely, yeah. So we're seeing a lot of, with COVID and everything else, there was a lot of younger demographic kind of buying over here. And there have been, little businesses that have popped up to help support that demographic, I guess, and younger kids and that kind of stuff. So I think that we'll continue to see that as, the collective consciousness of Vancouver is more aware of the Sunshine Coast. And we're starting to see more people migrate over this way. Much to the chagrin, I guess, of a lot of the retirees that were like not super into, having a younger demographic come in, but now it seems to be balancing out a little bit where we're not seeing as many people coming because a lot of them are being called back to work. But the ones that are coming, a really viable option is, one person is still commuting a little bit to the city and the other one is either buying or opening a small business on the coast and going from there.
We had a really big run-up in prices in the last couple of years here, so I think other places in Canada maybe roll their eyes when I say this, but compared to Vancouver, we're still relatively affordable on the Sunshine Coast.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you get a lot more for your dollar than, Burnaby, for example, or Vancouver, definitely on the North Shore. It is still very much kind of a country lifestyle over here. So, it's got a lot going for it, the Sunshine Coast, and especially if you're in that age group where you've got young kids or you're planning to have kids, that kind of stuff. It's a super safe environment and everyone's very friendly. And, we have talked about this, I think, in other podcasts, but like I don't think I've had keys in my house for the last 15 years or so, and there isn't a lot of crime going on.
Yeah.
So it is, it is a nice place, and when you stay here for too long and then go into the city or whatever, it kind of freaks you out.
It's a little bit of a culture shock. So you've convinced me that it's a good idea to buy or own a business on the Sunshine Coast. Mm-hmm. What kind of things are needed in Gibsons?
The main one that I feel we definitely need is a better sort of rideshare or taxi service. We are very limited on the amount of taxis that we have, and there is no Uber here. So it is quite problematic a lot of times that, you'll be out somewhere and, you can't get a taxi. So you're relying on, family members to pick you up or, having a long walk, that kind of stuff. So I'd say that's probably one of the things that's most in demand. The other thing is if there was a more reliable rideshare or a taxi service over here, it would reduce people's needs to get their cars on the ferry, which would reduce congestion at the ferry terminals. But there is really no option for someone coming over. The other upside to having something like that or maybe loosening up regulations on who can give people rides, that kind of thing, is a lot of the people that come from the city have stocked up at Costco or they've stocked up at Walmart or, their local grocery stores in the city, and they come over here. And so you lose a lot of that revenue that could be going into the local community just because they're bringing their car anyway. They may as well save a bit of money and buy some stuff in the city. So I'd say that's something that's definitely needed. More places that cater to kind of teenagers, I'd say there needs to be more like bubble tea shops or that type of thing.
probably our biggest industry on the coast is tourism. So there, I would imagine there's a lot of demand for businesses that serve that. So whether that's restaurants or hotels or anything kind of tourist related.
Yeah. So what we've seen from talking to, you know, business owners, that kind of stuff, while COVID happened is people were holidaying in their own backyard kind of thing. So we saw a big boom on the Sunshine Coast and businesses like Alpha Adventures, which is actually for sale right now, have done really, really well expanding, you know, their operations. They, you know, they do everything from kayak rentals to ski rentals up on Dakota Ridge, full service tours, that type of stuff, snowshoeing adventures. So anything, you know, with the kind of guides and caters to the tourists have done really well with that spike in tourism.
Something I personally find is that we're kind of short on tradespeople. So whether you need a handyman to come to the house or auto body repair or something like that, there always seems to be a shortage of that kind of thing on the coast. Mm-hmm. And I wonder what your thought on that is, if you've experienced the same thing.
Absolutely. Yeah. We had a lot of renovations done, I think like most, a lot of people did over the last year or two. And that's what we found, that there was a lot of waiting for trades guys, whether it's, you know, people to install flooring or tilers or carpenters or electricians. Everyone seems to be really, really busy. And there's a lot of waiting for
a lot of pent up demand.
Absolutely. Yeah. So there's a huge opportunity over here for anyone that's in construction and is, you know, reliable. You quite often sell homes to people that are moving over here and are in the trades. And, you know, so I'm fortunate I have relationships with them. But what I find is they'll move over here and then within 3 months, they're so busy that it's, you know, even a preferred customer like me can't get them to come out on short notice. So there is a huge demand for that on the coast.
When we talk about owning a business on the Sunshine Coast, you really have two options. You could start from scratch or you could buy an existing business. And I think sometimes people there's a romance with saying that they're going to start their own thing. But what would be a benefit to buying a business that already is in place?
The benefit would be the money that the existing business owner has invested in the business, whether it be leasehold upgrades, so like setting up counters and storage and, you know, depending on what it is, putting little rooms in, offices, that kind of stuff. I mean, getting tradespeople right now, like we just talked about, is very hard and it is quite expensive to do that. So any kind of space, no matter what the business is, if you're investing, you're looking at minimum probably $15,000 just to get it set up and get your permits and that kind of stuff, up to, you know, whatever, the sky's the limit on that. So that would be one benefit. Obviously, the goodwill. So if someone's selling a business, quite often, if they're an incorporation and that incorporation is just set up for the business, that incorporation's got all the relationships with suppliers and that kind of thing, and existing staff and you know, bank account set up and phone numbers and websites and all that stuff. So if you're buying if it's a share sale, and the benefit to the buyer is all of that stuff, it's just turnkey. They just take it over. They're now a director of the company and away they go. And the benefit, there's tax benefits, obviously, to the seller to do that. If it's an asset sale, so that's like someone that's a sole proprietor, that a lot of the businesses on the coast are, then what typically happens for like employees is they'll lay off the employees, pay out whatever severance they're owed, and then the new owner will then rehire those employees, and that, you know, their start date had reset. The goodwill would be a benefit. The taking over the employees would be a benefit. Having all the leasehold improvements already done would be a benefit. And taking over the established websites and, you know, the social media, that kind of stuff. Starting from scratch, if there isn't an existing business for sale that you can purchase, then obviously you don't have any choice but to start from scratch. And so at that point, you know, you're just looking for really the best location that you can, and making sure, what I found for businesses that do start from scratch, it is important to kind of come up with some sort of marketing plan to begin with, and make sure that you establish regular hours so that you're there all the time and you know, just, I guess, do what you say you're going to do, sometimes more, never less, kind of a good business strategy. And that's all the businesses that I've been involved with that have started out from scratch that have followed that have been successful.
Home prices on the Sunshine Coast are way up over the last couple of years. And is it a similar scenario for commercial or industrial properties?
If it's real property, so if they're actually selling commercial property with the business, because quite often, whether it's a share and asset sale with the business, they won't own the property that they're operating out of. They're tied into a lease. So in that scenario, one of the subjects of the offer is them making sure that they can secure a lease for, you know, another five or five plus a 5-year renewal, 10-year lease, because that way their investment that they're making, they're assured that they can get a return on. If you own a business without a lease, and you don't own the property and you don't have a lease, it's a much harder sell, because someone's outlaying money and then the landlord may not renew that lease, or they may want to drastically increase the rent. So commercial property itself we have noticed quite a bit of a boom from it. Commercial, not so much. So there have been, like restaurants, for example, have had struggles. They're having struggles now with employees, that kind of thing. But the takeout restaurants seem to have done really, really well over COVID, right? They've actually gone up. So it is very, I guess, specific to different businesses. But in general, we have not seen a run on businesses like we did a run on residential homes. And I think that's partly because the majority of people that were driving the prices up had jobs where they felt that they were working from home. They weren't necessarily coming and planning on, they weren't leaving the city to start a new life here. They were just taking advantage of the ability to relocate and work remotely. And then, you know, all of the amenities and all of the things that make the Sunshine Coast, you know, a great place to live, it was really, really appealing to them. So that was more of the driver for that.
I think the biggest change recently to our real estate market, well, not just ours, but nationally, is we had a pretty substantial interest rate increase. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering how that's affected the market here on the Sunshine Coast.
It's had the desired effect. I'm not sure that they're actually, you know, that the decisions are being made to slow real estate markets down, that kind of stuff. I'm sure that it's just being done to get ahead of inflation. And I feel it's kind of inevitable that was going to happen given, you know, what's been going on the last couple of years. And you know, they've basically been printing money and handing it out to keep the economy going. So now they've got to get a handle on that. And as a result, interest rates are going up. The market, you know, prior to this last full point increase was slowing down. This is slowing it down even further. From everything I've read, you know, it's highly likely we're going to be in a recession next year. So I think that, you know, we're going to see continue adjustment of prices down until Q1 next year, maybe Q2 next year, and then we're going to be in a buyer's market. And how long that lasts for will be, anyone's guess, I guess. Depends on how quickly the economy recovers.
When the market was so hot, the prices just increased every month. And is that the inverse true now, that the market is cooling and that prices are pulling back every month?
Yeah. So what we're seeing is buyers are sitting on their hands. The only real offers that we're seeing, and this for me, I've noticed this over the last 6 or 7 weeks, is the only offers that buyer's agents are getting out of their buyers are lowball offers, or offers that the buyers think are ahead of the market. And sellers need to adjust their expectations, because a lot of sellers are still thinking that their homes are worth you know, what they were worth last year at this time, and it's just not true. It's just not the facts. So I'm going to have a few hard conversations with, you know, a few of my listings to get that expectation adjusted. And if sellers aren't willing to do that, then, you know, they're going to be chasing the market down, so to speak. And, you know, there isn't really a lot that we can do at this time. I mean, there's going to be more interest rate increases, but before the end of the year, from everything I've read. So it's just going to continue to, you know, to kind of settle into a buyer's market.
If there's this downward pressure on prices, then what is your advice to sellers in this kind of market?
If you have an investment property that you're making good money on, so say you have an Airbnb that is zoned correctly and licensed and you're making good money on, you're probably better off hanging on to that, because I don't see the drive for people to you know, vacation in their backyard diminishing at all. So I'd probably hang on to those properties. If it is something that you need to sell, so say you've got an Airbnb and you're in an area where they are changing the zoning and you do need to sell it, I'd get on it sooner rather than later. We are seeing a lot of inventory coming on the market. Like I track it through the market reports and that kind of stuff that I do. So you can see just an increase in the amount of inventory and a decrease in the amount of sales that are happening. So buyers have much more choice, and that's just going to continue to increase over the next little bit. Traditionally, you know, July is slow. Summer's a slow time. People kind of put real estate on the back burner and go on vacations. And I think that's even more this year, just because people have been away for the last, you know, not been able to vacation for the last couple of years. I mean, you see on the news what's happening with airports and all that kind of stuff. I mean, there's a lot of people vacationing, and when they get back in September, will there, you know, be a run on the market? Will we see a little bit of a bump in sales and that kind of stuff? But very likely no. And it's just going to be quiet, you know, between now and the end of the year. So if you are looking to sell, you really want to kind of make your property appealing to someone that wants to buy it and get ahead of the market and not end up overpricing it and chasing the market down, which a lot of people are doing. We're seeing $250,000, $120,000, $80,000 price reductions happening in the last week. I think I've seen 7 or 8 of them, which are substantial price reductions. 10-15% of the ask price has been taken off of stuff, and that's what you need to do. Like, people are doing that and they're selling. But buyer's agents are having trouble getting buyers to write offers unless they're lowball offers. My advice is, if you do end up having a listing and you do get an offer, don't be offended. Respond to the offer. Worst thing you can do is get a lowball offer and not respond to it, because, you know, you don't know if they're just kind of feeling you out to start with, and you know, and they are legitimate. But it's worth getting your agent to at least respond to the offer, even if you don't change your price at all, to see if they were just trying it out. Because there are going to be some desperate people. There are some desperate people out there right now that are overextended and can't necessarily make their mortgage payments, so they need to sell. So buyers are out there taking advantage in the same way that sellers were taking advantage of lack of inventory and holding offers and using, you know, marketing strategies like that. So now it's kind of the buyer's turn to get a pound of flesh out of the sellers, and that's the reality. And if you are a seller and you take 3 months to figure that out, that you're going to be leaving money on the table if you do actually need to sell. If you don't need to sell, it might not be the best time to do that.
If you're in a position where you do have to sell and you're a motivated seller, I've heard you talk about pricing and exposure being the key to getting a house sold.
Yeah, absolutely. There's two things that sell homes. One's exposure, the other one's pricing. So if you're priced right and the house isn't selling, that means that you're not exposed. So quite often you'll run across a FSBO or, you know, some other service, you know, like that leaves it to the homeowner to market their property themselves, and the property doesn't sell just because the populace isn't aware of it, or the buyers that are in that area. If you work with a realtor that sells a lot in an area and knows what they're doing as far as marketing goes, then odds are anyone that could potentially want to buy the house that you're selling is going to be aware of it. And those stats are readily available. If you're working with a real estate agent, they can give you that information, how many people saw your property, what kind of response you're getting, how it stacks up against other comparable properties. And then when you're armed with that information and you know that you have the exposure, then if you don't get offers and you're not getting showings, then that means your price is too high. And in a market like this, you can't wait for the market to catch up to your price. You've got to get ahead of it. Or, you know, if there isn't really any point living with a listing that isn't getting any showings, if you don't really need to sell, now isn't the time to be, to be hanging it out there.
The interest rate increase was a big story coast to coast across Canada. A little bit closer to home was that the BC provincial government expanded its investment tax, its speculation tax, but did not include the Sunshine Coast. So Whistler, Sunshine Coast, and the Gulf Islands are excluded. And I'm wondering what your thoughts are. Is that a good thing or a bad thing for the Sunshine Coast?
I think depending on what your position is, I mean, if you're a seller, I mean, that's something that's going to potentially make the Sunshine Coast appealing to a certain type of buyer, right? In the last few months, I've had a couple of buyers from Europe come and buy property because they wanted to get their money out of, in one case, Germany, because it's, you know, close to Ukraine or whatever they're kind of worried about. So so I've seen a little bit of that, and I mean, us not having a speculation tax in place would maintain us being appealing to those potential buyers. We haven't had speculation tax for a long time, and we haven't seen that driving a lot of foreign investment in my experience, right? We don't see a lot of like mainland Chinese buyers buying over here and parking money and that kind of stuff. I mean, I'm sure there's some, but it's not a big part. Like, our main buyer group are retirees still, and we got bumped by you know, younger buyers that felt that they could work from home, and so that's what's kind of spiked it. We're not seeing a huge foreign buyer investment that's driving prices up, even though, you know, that is a common misconception, or people, you know, believe that that's the case. I would assume that the powers that be in the Fed or whoever's making these decisions on where the speculation tax is being applied are looking at things like density and median house price. And if they're doing that, then probably over, you know, looking at the whole of the province, they're saying that the Gulf Islands and Whistler and the Sunshine Coast are not at the same density, and their prices aren't as high, and so that's where they want to push that foreign investment money, because I'm sure that, you know, we still want that, but they don't want it in higher density and higher priced areas. So I think, you know, if you're a seller, it's a good thing. Potentially, if we start to see some of that investment as a buyer, if we do see a lot of that investment, that's going to help curb, I guess, the correction in price, and therefore it might not necessarily be a good thing if you're a buyer. But in general, I think that, you know, it's a benefit to the real estate market if we're looking at it from that perspective, because it does make us appealing to people that, you know, want to invest and don't want to pay that speculation tax.
Our focus in this episode of the podcast has been businesses and commercial spaces. So with that in mind, what commercial spaces or businesses do you have for sale this month?
I have quite a few. It's been busy. I have noticed an uptick in activity on the commercial side, both with, you know, people inquiring about them, which, you know, I mean, it's timely for us to be doing this this podcast on this topic. And a lot of people have been in touch to list their businesses. So I have a higher profile one coming on called Slugger's Gym, which is a long established, fantastic gym that's going to be coming on in the next couple of days. There's one called Ideas Space, which is like a tutoring business, which is up across from the high school. And that's really successful. A lot of really nice restaurants. I've got one up in Seashell called Ty's Bistro. That's a really good opportunity for someone right in the hub of the CBD area in Seashell there. And I've got the Pink House, which is a restaurant down in Lower Gibsons, long established, lots of goodwill in that one. They've recently done a bunch of upgrades and stuff, so that's an excellent opportunity for someone. And then there's a florist in the Upper Gibsons. I'm not naming all the businesses, but if people want to come and check out the website, they're all on there. There's information packs and I can send them out. But the florist is a great little business, and that really does take advantage, like you were talking about before, of its proximity to Vancouver. So that one's available too. So lots of stuff. And some more stuff coming up, some raw spaces. If people, you know, have a vision and none of the business that we have listed work for them, they want to try something else out, that's there too.
Because it's summertime, I like to go in, like everybody else, spend time around the water. And I think you've got an outfitter that's for sale.
Yeah, so Alpha Adventures. So there's actually three locations there. One of them seasonal up in Pender Harbour, but they've got two main ones. One in Lower Gibsons, right in the marina there, and then their main store in Wilson Creek. So all three of those locations are included in what's on offer there. They've done so well over the last couple of years. The owners are a couple of school teachers that have built this up over the past decade or so, and now they're ready to move on with the kids getting a bit older and that kind of stuff. So it's a really good opportunity, Alpha Adventures, and really good financials, and great opportunity year round as well, because they rent kayaks. It's ski rental up at Dakota Ridge. They do guided tours.
And it's retail, like if you want to go buy hiking boots or camping equipment
and
or whatever.
Exclusive for a lot of the products and that kind of stuff. So they've kind of got the market cornered there, and that's a really good opportunity as well.
Thanks for watching, and if you haven't already, please consider subscribing. While you're here, maybe you want to check out one of my listings or watch my video about why you should choose me to sell your home.